Good morning. I restarted the recording to try to get the music to go away after much technical difficulties. Hopefully we are here and ready to roll today. You may see two dogs in the background today. Sierra's got her best buddy Toby, and he's over there with her, and he's a little stressed out. He gets a little anxious when his mom and dad aren't around, so I think you may hear some crying from him periodically, but he's fine. He's just a whiner. So good morning, good morning. Welcome to everybody, especially the people who are here at Ustream for the first time. We have our regular Thursday night show, but today we're doing a special Ustream broadcast for our seminar. We're doing a series of seminars every 2 months on really cool design topics for card makers. And we're going to try this one on Ustream and see how it works. It's recorded, and there's also going to be text written up for the blog on the Stars and Stamps blog, so you'll be able to read more of it and see more of the pictures up close when the time comes. So let's see a little bit about Ustream. This thing may get wonky from time to time. If it does, please don't get too panicky. There's a button in the lower left corner. It looks like two little circle arrows going around each other, and you can try to refresh. You may have to rewatch the ads, but hopefully that will get you back on track. And if I get lost, I may end up having to restart my script a little bit to reintroduce it, because if it boots me, it also stops the recording. So we're going to see how that goes. If you're wondering how to do the cute little claps that everybody's doing right now in the chat, you can type the word clap in parentheses, and that makes the little happy clapper person, little smiley face. So if you see something you like, then type that. I'm going to try to watch the chat as we go, but I'm not really good at doing two things at once. I'm trying to follow my written description that I've put down so that I don't get too off topic. But I will attempt to peek in on chat and see if there's any questions as we go. And there's also a little bit of lag, so I may go backwards a few seconds in time to get to your questions and answering them. So let us begin. I wanted to start with a quote that I found, and I thought it was really, really cool and kind of pertinent. And it's by somebody named Bernice Fitzgibbon. And the quote is, "Creativity often consists of merely turning up what's already there. Did you know that right and left shoes were thought up only a little more than a century ago?" Which I thought was really amazing that somebody suddenly thought that maybe you could have a left and a right shoe. Can you imagine what shoes would have felt like if they were all the same shoe? We only know left and right shoes, but somebody decided to take an invention that was already there, shoes, and make left and rights out of them. And that's kind of what we're talking about in our design seminars, is taking what we already do and what we already create in our cards and just turning it up a notch and just, you know, taking everybody to the next step, the next level in their card making, because we want to all get better at what we do. Everybody has a chance to step it up just a little bit. So today's topic is about texture and dimension, because we do get a lot of questions about it. Our guidelines state that lumpy cards are okay, as long as they're not too lumpy. So what the heck does that mean? So first, you need to know that there are all sorts of items that create dimension and texture on cards. There's layers of all sorts of paper, which it can be designer paper, which is thinner, designer cardstock, which is a little thicker, or regular cardstock, which is thicker still. There's ones with textures in them, or you can emboss a texture. there's also all sorts of embellishments, and we'll have a little discussion about what embellishments are too thick for cards and which ones work well, and all sorts of dimensional adhesives as well. Now, the dimensional adhesives are kind of the big one that I wanted to cover. There are packs of circles or squares, and of course, you'd think I'd have that out right at my fingertips somewhere here. I used to use, and they're not here, of course, these squares. I do have a picture of it, so I will put the picture up instead. How about that? There are these squares, and they have, they just come with, you know, sticky back on one side, and you peel off the paper on the other side. There's also rolls. You can see that green adhesive with the green back on it, and those are much thinner. You can see in the photo the difference between the two of them. And that's typically the difference between a lot of them. You want to go with the thinnest dimensional adhesive that you can. So there's the packs of circles or squares. Some people call them pop dots. There's also glue dots, pardon me, that add dimension as well, that are really thick. And I don't recommend those simply because they create a gap in the card, and they're also super sticky. And when they're super sticky and something sticks in between them, another card or an envelope gets in between your embellishment or your layer of paper and the background paper that it's stuck on, you'll end up with something else getting really stuck to it. Other adhesives don't cause that much of a problem, but the super thick glue dots really, really are an issue. So we prefer to stay away from those. Question is, where do you get the thin green thingy? I have in front of me my very favorite. This is Scotch. I think it's Scotch that makes this. Let me see if I can find the new pack, because being me, I had to make sure that I had a brand new pack in case I ever ran out of the old. And of course, I've been using it for a month and I still have only used like that much of it. So it'll last a long time, but it's by Scotch and it's called Permanent Mounting Tape. You can get this at craft stores. You can also get it at office supply stores. This giant roll, it's the biggest one I've ever seen, and I got it at the office Costco, and it's like $24. And of course, the rolls are normally much smaller. They're, normal sized. So that huge roll is only for obsessive people like me. Or if your craft group wants to go in on one together to get a big one. But yes, no fair hoarding it. I realize that, but there you go. For anybody in Washington, there is an office Costco in Fife. And that's the one I got that at. Anyway, they come in all different sorts of packs, and you can get them at Joann's. Use your 40% off coupon, and I think Michaels carries it too, so you can get them inexpensively. So that is the dimensional adhesive we prefer, just because it's not as thick. There are some by other companies like Stampin' Up! And various places like that, and you can certainly use those as well. You just want to go with the thinnest that you possibly can, and you'll see why as we get into it. One of the questions we get a lot is, what is too much dimension? How thick is too thick? So for our boxes, if we had all completely flat cards in them, we have two rows in each box, and if we had all completely flat cards, we would fit so many cards in there, it would be crazy. Which would be fine to fit that many cards in there, because we'd have that many more heroes who could write home. But it would also get really boring if all the cards were the same, if they all had just one layer on them. So we like to have a really good range. We like to have some that are lumpy, some that are thin, some that are in the middle. And so whatever you do, you're going to fit into that range. So you're fine wherever you're at. But we want to make sure that we don't get too lumpy, because when they get too lumpy, we also, one card can take up the space of three or four cards, and we really don't want to go there. We want to try to get as many cards as we can in. And those are also a problem for the mail. These things still have to go through the post office, through their machines. So we want to make sure that the cards actually make it to the people they're intended to get to, instead of getting chewed up by the machines. So on dimensional layers, when you use dimensional adhesive, don't stack up layer and then layer and then layer and then layer. There are some designs, like I've seen, where someone will print out an image and they'll print out a whole bunch of copies, and then it'll get smaller and smaller and smaller, and then they make a giant tower out of it and it's like six layers thick. That's a little too much. We want to stick with two stacked on top of each other if you're using the thin stuff, or just one layer if you're using the thicker dimensional adhesive, because we really don't want them to be giantly thick. And if you use the, like I said, the thin, I'm sorry, I'm looking at my notes and rereading things. If you use a thin Scotch mounting tape, you can get away with two layers, but we'll also talk a little bit about balance on the card as well. One of our biggest issues with embellishments that are too thick is buttons. Now, thin buttons, like shirt buttons, are totally fine. you know, they're thin. We don't want to use, again, the dimensional adhesive. Use the thinner of the glue dots, not the really big fat ones. Because again, they create that gap, and then the glue sticks out and it sticks to the envelopes and makes a mess in the boxes. So the shirt style buttons are fine, but anything that starts getting thicker, or they get lumpy or vintage, and especially anything with the little loop on the back, definitely a no-no. If it's a really flat button, you can cut off that loop with a pair of, I don't know, I've used wire cutters for various things before to cut those off. But the button itself should still be pretty thin. You don't want those big bowl-shaped buttons, because they are giant. And they make giant messes on the cards. And even some of the 3D stickers also, and brads, all those sort of things that people like to stick in the middle of a flower. If you use 3 or 4 flowers in a row, and then a button, and then a brad, it just gets to be way too thick as well. So, you know, you don't want to stack things too deep, too high. However, I'll put a caveat on all of this. If you really love to make giant, super thick embellishments, make an Any Hero card out of them. That's all you have to do, and you can make it as thick as you want. You can make it, you know, a half an inch thick. Totally fine. Let me see. Where are my notes? And then to get to balance, I've talked to a couple of postal workers, and their official line has to be anything lumpy will get stuck in the machines. Don't want to deal with that. But my postal workers at the counter have told me that the way that the machines work, if the whole card is relatively thick, it will go through okay. If they put it through and then the first half is really thin, it's just one layer, and then bang, you have a giant button, that will get caught. Or if you have, bang, a giant ribbon, a big knot in your ribbon, that will get stuck. So their recommendation is to have it be relatively even. Now, I do have people that have tried to follow my directions when I said balance out one side. If you have, you know, something thicker on one side, put something thicker on the other side. And then you just have a lump on one side, and then it goes way down to thin, and then a lump on the other. You really want the card to be relatively even, and I'll show you what that means in some samples later on. Just so that the card doesn't have giant lumps in various places. If you run your hand across it and you start feeling like a single lump in one spot, that's where a problem is. There's recently there's been this popularity for these little teeny tiny flowers. Well, some of them are a little bigger, and they are like little rocks. They're like little kidney stones or something. I don't know what they are, but a lot of people are starting to glue those on, and I have to take all those off. Those don't work. They are just giant. It's like having a little pebble on the card. And those little page pebbles are okay, but like these are bigger. They're like flower things. Anyway, so that is the intro to things, and I think now we might be ready to go see some cards. Would you guys like to see some cards? Because I have a whole box full of great card samples to show you. Well, some are great card samples. And we'll start off with some much simpler ones. Let me turn on the old eyeball camera so I can show you some of these. Maybe I will move the camera a little closer so you can see better. About that. That's better. If I can go left, right, the correct direction. Here we go. So this card, and I will have photos on the blog later so you can see them closer. This card just has one layer stamped on cardstock, and this is one of those pre-purchased card bases, so it has white on the inside, and it's a nice weight, and just has a butterfly glued on it, and the cinnamon is stamped on it. It's very simple, perfectly fine, but in order to pop that with a little bit of dimension, and it's not a whole lot, doesn't take much, here's a revise of that card. Maybe I'll move this back so you can see both at the same time. The card base has now been put onto, or the plain paper has been put onto another card base of a slightly different color, gives it just a little bit more detail around it. Then the image itself was cut out and layered on an orange paper. It's the same orange paper that matches that, and just created a little flag for the sentiment. It's not a huge deal, but what this does, just adding that little cardstock layer, and it's not a designer paper layer, when you put this butterfly on it this time, that causes this to look like it's popped off the card a little bit more. This one is glued just flat down, but it doesn't have anything to hang off of. And this one, however, it hangs off of those two paper layers, the thin paper layer of the stamped image and then the thicker cardstock. So it looks like it's three-dimensional even when it's really, there's no layers, there's no dimensional adhesive attached underneath this at all. So, pretty simple way to jazz up a really simple card. Now next, I will show you this card. And this, we get a lot of this kind of a thing. This card used to have a flower down there, but the flower fell off, apparently. The sample on the blog will have the fourth flower. But we'll get people who will trim out all of the pattern paper and everything with either border punches or with decorative scissors. And you start losing the fact that you've got this beautiful pattern paper behind it. And you lose the definition between the paper and the image. You lose the definition of the flowers. It just sort of falls a little bit on the flat side. So here I took and made a few changes to it. I left three of the sides of both of the papers rectangular instead of all cut on the edges. And then only one of the edges on each one is decorative on the bottom. And so they're not every single one of them decorated up, but you're reserving that fanciness for just one edge, which really draws the attention to it rather than here, you know, when all of it is the same, you sort of lose the effect. But here, this has also been layered on a matching paper. We took the yellow from here and used a matching yellow paper for a layer around the sentiment. And that makes that pop off of here. There's also a little thin dimensional underneath of this. And it's just a little bit, it's not a ton, but it's enough to make it separate from this because here it just sort of disappeared into the pattern paper. And there's a real clear definition. The flowers were also gathered into two spots instead of being all over the card, and they're doubled up. This was just a single flower. Sorry, now the cat is in the background arguing with the dogs. So they're gathered into two spots instead of being randomly all over the card. And if you saw our sneeze episode of the TV show recently, you can tell the difference between those. And there's also a brad added to the middle, and the brad matches the paper, so it just ties them all together a whole lot better. Dixie, the background paper was overwhelming on the first one, and here it takes a back seat to the sentiment. And I see a question about what is a border punch? And I will grab one and show you. If I can find one here. Okay, this is a border punch. It's not the one I used here, but I'll show you real quickly what it does on a scrap of paper. These work similar to decorative edge scissors. And you put your paper in and punch it, and it cuts the pattern. And then you line it up, you slide it down a little bit further, and line it up. There's a place, the pattern is repeated right here. So I'm lining up where where it's already been cut. Press it again, and it just keeps going down the entire border. So it makes actually a straight pattern instead of when you're using your decorative edge scissors. I'm one of those who's really inept at cutting with decorative edge scissors, and this actually allows you to cut a straight fancy pattern. So I've replaced all my decorative edge scissors with really cool border punches. So there's that card. Now we have another one here. I wanted to show you the sketch that it's based on prior to showing you the card itself, because I use all the sketches from our blog for these cards here. This one is sketch number 2. And the first card that I made with it is this one. Now, you know, it's perfectly fine for a card, not a problem. It's, you know, a very simple design. I did the stitching by hand with a pen. There's no dimension added to it at all yet, except there's a layer of blue, a layer of white, and a layer of red behind this. And it's textured cardstock. I don't know if you can probably see that or not, but there's a little texture to the cardstock. And that's it. It's a fine card, but it has lots of opportunities to spark it up with a little dimension. So I'm going to show you a series of examples to show you how I spiced that one up. With this, I added this is a Stampin' Up! Cuddlebug folder. And so there's texture added to that. There is texture added to the red. So there's stars behind that. If you can see the stars there. There's a little bit of dimension added here. Just one little piece of the dimensional adhesive. And that alone made it a much sparkier card. Because it's got a little more texture to it. You know, it makes you want to touch it and feel it. So there's that. Now you can take it another level. And there's this one. So now this, if you can see that, the white layer has dimensional adhesive underneath of it. Let me see if I can get that in the right light. The white layer has adhesive. The white star has dimensional adhesive. And the red star has dimensional adhesive. The paper itself is cuddlebugged now. You can see the Swiss dots pattern on that. And there's been a ribbon and a giant flag brad added. So there's gobs of dimension on this. Now this is too much dimension. This is one of those that our shippers would take it apart and somehow reduce that. That's just giantly huge. However, for an Any Hero card, which is what this is, that's perfectly fine to have that many layers, and you can dress those up all you want because it's going to have a note written inside of it to a hero, and it does not need to go through the post office. And yes, to answer the question, these will be posted on the blog. I do have pictures of these. So coming back from that one a little bit to something that will be sendable through the mail is this one. Now what I did was there's only a little bit of adhesive, a dimensional adhesive behind the white. And then there's one little piece behind the star. And that's the only dimension in that. So it's much thinner than this was. I don't know if you can see the difference between those. It's just not nearly as thick. And it also has this bottom portion added. And this is where I was talking about balance. So when this is in an envelope and the machine is running across the whole thing, it's going to feel it like it's all got lumps in it. So we added the cardstock at the bottom and a knot here. Instead of a bow, and I'll show you some ribbon things too later, knots tend to be flatter than bows, so I tend to use those a lot more. So this card is much more appropriate for sending through the mail. So there is that example. Let's find what's next in my little box. Okay, this one is a card we get a lot of. You know, a lot of folks follow our sketches, and this is one that is based on this sketch. So there's a circle, there's a rectangle in the middle, and two pieces of patterned paper behind it. And so that's where this card began. And we'll get a lot of folks who will just follow the pattern exactly, and they will just place the pattern papers on there. Perfectly fine to do that. This one also has a little decorative edge around the sentiment because I wanted it to pop a little bit. So I just tapped the edge of my chalk ink pad around it so that it would at least have a little definition around it. Now, this is fine, but this again has lots of opportunities for making, you know, making it a little fancier with some dimension added to it. So the first one that I tried was just to add a little bit. And this adds a scallop around it. And you can do the same thing too with a rectangle. So if you don't have a round circle punch and nestabilities and that sort of thing, you can do the same with a square image and just add a square of red around it, a contrasting color. And then I added a piece of ribbon to define between those two. So it's just splitting each of the shapes, each of the patterns, with definition around them of some sort. So I also added red cardstock around this green piece, and I took my red magic marker, my Copic marker, because Copics will color on metal, and I changed these to be red so that those red elements start tying together. There's also a little bit of dimensional adhesive just behind that piece, but it's just the really thin stuff, so you don't see much, but it's enough to just really make the card feel like it's starting to pop. I wanted to take that one another step because you guys know me. I love to totally trick things out. So I went one more step with this card. And I used a different nestability around it and I popped that one. So there's a little bit of dimensional behind that. And then I added two layers in here. There's a cream layer and the cream ties it in with the cream that I used for the cinnamon. So it ties those two together much better than it did. And I left that one rectangular, but I used a border punch along the bottom of that piece. And if you wanted to know how I did it, I border punched the paper, then I glued the cream and the green onto it, and then I trimmed around them so that that's how I got that edge to be where I wanted it, so that I could place that green paper where I wanted before cutting it out. Because otherwise it's hard to line your border punch up to give you the exact edge that you want. On this card, I also added ribbon right across here with just a really simple knot tied around that middle piece. And the background this time, I put it on red cardstock. It isn't on a whole red card base, but I cut a 5.5 by 4.25 piece of red. And then I cut the papers just a little bit smaller. So instead of having the ribbon dividing them like this, the paper itself divides them. So it's a little simpler that way. So there's that one, and I did another version of it because I know not everybody is into red and contrast. Some people like pink, so I did the very same thing with pink, very same process, and made just a softer card. So I'm going to check real quick and see what other questions there are because I see there's some chatter going on. I see people who love their nestabilities get them on eBay for $10. That's always good. And yes, the dimensional adhesive that I use, these are the dimensional adhesives I had in my stash. I took pictures of these earlier. Someone was just asking who was a latecomer. The thin stuff with the green background is what I typically use. When I say thin adhesive, that's what I'm talking about. The white stuff is just a little thicker and it's a little more challenging to make a card that's not going to be too thick for the post office to send. And if you look at the little picture of me, I will hold up again my delicious giant roll of this mounting tape dimensional adhesive. So there is the pink version of that card. Let's see. Yes, Copic markers do dry quickly, so coloring those metal pieces worked just fine. And trying to make sure I check into a few other questions. Do we send friends cards a lot? A lot of people do make friends cards, and that's fine. A range of cards is great, sometimes for family members, other times for friends. Cheapest big shot is at Sizzix Outlet. So anybody who's watching this video later, you're missing all of these wonderful places everybody's saying for where to purchase various of these craft items and tools. And so you're going to want to tune in to our show when you see that we've got one coming up. So I want to show you a couple of other cards. These are cards not made by me, but these were made by various card makers who have sent me things. Now, this one was a card that was sent in an envelope. It was sent by Barb as a Get Well card for me. But I wanted to show you that this is, oops, I should show you in the light so you can see it. This is way too thick for one of our regular cards. But she was sending it to me just as a friend card. And it's an absolutely gorgeous flower. I just love it. But that would not work for a regular card. But it is absolutely gorgeous for an Any Hero card. So if you love to make flowers like that, just write a note in them. That's all that that takes. Here is one made by, does not say by whom, but I thought it was very cute. There's a little bit of dimensional adhesive behind this layer, but the rest of the dimension on it is really done by layers of cardstock. And so this is a really nice, hefty cardstock for the card base, and each one of these layers is done with cardstock. So it's a very nice, beefy card. And we can do rectangular cards, or not rectangular, square cards. I do have some envelopes, but we prefer if you send in large square cards that you send in your own envelopes for them, because then we have to go out and procure some from somewhere. But I have some that I've purchased for my own cards because I do like to make square ones. If you make 4 1/4 by 4 1/4 or less, you can do small square cards that fit into A2 envelopes. Here's another one with a lot of really fun texture to it. This is felt that was used for the clouds on it. And they used some lace, a little bit of lace border around the card. Now, a caveat on using things like felt. A lot of people will like to punch things out and use their die cutters to put felt pieces on. Here, the thing that I love about this is that the felt pieces work with the image. It's not just random butterflies punched out of felt, that sort of thing. We do get a lot of that. So try to make your felt pieces, if you're going to use them, make them integrate with your design, which is very cool. And also on the lace, and I'll show you another one with some lace on it. There's two of them that were absolutely gorgeous. You can use things like lace on a card, but my recommendation is not to use a giant piece of fabric or lace that you have to adhere to the front of the card, because on something like this, if you had to glue it down, you're going to have a lot of glue sticking out in between all of those spots. So she wrapped the lace around the cardstock and glued it on the back, which worked nicely. But many fabrics, people try to use fabric instead of pattern paper, and that really doesn't stick very well. So be very, very careful if you're going to use any fabric. But this one is really, really beautiful. There's no dimensional adhesive on it, but it feels very textural and dimensional because you've got these layers. And then this one, actually, yeah, there is a little bit of dimension. There's a little dimensional adhesive under this side. So they didn't put the dimensional adhesive on this side. They only put one piece here. I can feel one little piece here. And then they used the fact that this was layered as the other half of the dimension. So if they had added dimensional adhesive on this side, then this one would be way tall and this one would be way low. So that's another way to get around having too much adhesive, dimensional adhesive, but you're also flattening out that card. Again, it feels more like one layer because this side is popped and this side has the layers of paper and lace underneath of it. So that is a really pretty one. And here's another one with, again, this the white image has a little little dimensional adhesive underneath of it, but the rest is just done with cardstock layers, and really, really pretty. Not a whole lot to say about that. It's really cute. The coloring is adorable, and of course, I love little metal embellishments. I think they're really pretty. And let's see. Oh, here's one more with lace on it, which is really beautiful as well. Again, the lace is adhered underneath of the card. And this is also, you probably can't see it, but this knot is very flat. It looks like a big fat ribbon, but it really lays flat. However she tied this, which I have not been able to figure out, it's a very flat bow. And I'm going to show you a little bit about ribbons and bows in a few minutes. But this one, It isn't even. It would be helpful if this was on a layer down here so that it would raise that up and even it out a little bit more, but this is a pretty darn flat bow as far as bows go. And then I want to show you a bunch of Jody's cards. Jody's one of our card makers. She just sent in this box last week, and I talked about her, talked with her about it and told her I was going to show off some of her beautiful cards. She doesn't do stamped images, so she was feeling embarrassed, but I said, your cards are so pretty. She gets a lot of dimension and texture without even really adding much dimension to them. Questions on here. Sorry about going backwards into chat for a moment. That heart was inked. And metal embellishments do not get stuck in the postal machines when they're that thin. This is a super, super thin metal embellishment. It's also lower than the, it's on a layer that's lower than the the dimensional adhesive under here. So that's basically going to hide it as the machine goes over it. It's not going to get stuck on that. So there we go. Okay, this one. She gets a lot of her, Jody gets a lot of her dimension from the colors and papers that she uses. I mean, this is just absolutely stunning in my mind. I just absolutely love her style. There's a little dimensional adhesive underneath of the this round piece, but the rest of it is flat. This is ribbon here, so she gets a little bit more texture. And wrapping the ribbon underneath of and underneath of the pattern paper, layering all of it on a really nice piece of textured cardstock. And then just adds a little bit of bling. I mean, I just think that is absolutely adorable. How does she make her sentiments without stamping? She does stamp her sentiments. She just doesn't do stamping and coloring of images. What about writing hand cancel on the cards? That doesn't really help a whole lot. I mean, it sort of may, but you have to actually include envelopes if you write that on your envelope. Do we take cards and reassemble when they're too thick? Often we do, so they end up in the hospital boxes. So we want to make sure we do as little as possible of that. Here's another of Jody's cards. Now this one borders on whether or not it's too thick. There's a that button. You can see that button on there. Is pretty flat. It's a little bit on the thick side, but it's really, really flat. And it's balanced out by this other one. So when the machine goes over it, it's not going to get stuck on that. If the rest of the card was all one layer and had this giant, this big button on it, it would likely catch on it. So, as I said, keeping it somewhat even so that you're not just having one giant flower or button or whatever on a card. Is really helpful for postal worker peoples. So, and I'm pulling out more of Jody's cards because I just love them. Really pretty. She's using a lot of textured, I think it's Basil cardstock. Does this textured cardstock or else it's, I'm not sure if it's coordinations, but it's got, let me see if I can show you. It's got texture to it and that comes with the paper. That's not anything she embossed. And she just uses pattern papers to create layers. There's a border punch used to create that scallop, a pattern paper here, and a pattern paper here, and a little bit of raffia around it. And on this one, her button is really thin, and her flower is really thin. So she doesn't have a whole ton of stuff on it. It's not a giant lump. So that one would go through the post office just fine. And let's see, we have another Jody here. Really pretty pink and black combo, which is fantastic. Her buttons, again, are really thin buttons that she uses. They're super, super thin. And I love thin buttons because I'm a real buttonaholic, and I like it when you can use them and not have to worry about them getting jammed in the postal machines. So again, she uses lots of border punches and stuff. She uses one of my favorite, which is has the scallop and the little holes. And she's got a couple of buttons on it, but they're, again, they're thin, so it's fine. Let's see, I have two more Jodies here. And there's this one, which is lovely. There's a little dimensional adhesive under here, which balances it out with this. This flower, the flower is the thick part here, and then you have all these layers which make that a little bit thicker. So the whole card itself is approximately the same thickness. And so the postal machines are not going to eat it nearly as much. So you can see she also uses pretty small or pretty thin bling on it. There are some people that use giant super round pearls, and those will often catch. So we will often have to remove some of those. And here's one more by Jody. Again, she uses super paper combinations, and there's a little bit of dimensional adhesive under here. But it doesn't take much to really make a card pop nicely and to really feel like it's a special card without getting too ginormously thick. And let's see, a couple of more little cards in my box. This one is by Rhonda in Canada. Again, she uses gorgeous color combinations and paper combinations and very thin flowers. And the flowers balance out, the flowers and the layers here balance out with that ribbon. The ribbon is on the edge of what's too lumpy, but it's still okay. And with that, I will show you some ribbon things, because I'm always getting asked about ribbons and bows. So these are some of my my ribbons that tie bows on the flatter side. So they're a little bit, they're mostly usable. Silk ribbons, if you can tie a ribbon right, you can make that knot pretty small, and it can get pretty flat, and those can be okay. This is an even thinner silk ribbon, so the knot is not really huge. You just don't want those knots to be really big. This one is organdy, and of course that's really super flat. This is a new ribbon to me. I think it's called wrinkle ribbon. And it makes a superbly flat knot. I absolutely love this stuff, and I think I'm gonna buy it in a whole bunch of different colors. And then there's this ribbon, and I can't remember what it's called, but it's got the little ridges in it. This stuff is where you start getting into really giant knots in it. And I'm not smart enough really to be capable of tying bows without giant knots in them. We may have some tutorials in our future for how to do those better, but I wanted to show you some other ideas. This is this very thick, gorgeous, yummy ribbon that I just got on the sale that we had on the OWH site. One of our partners offered us a sale on ribbon, and I bought a whole bunch, and this is gorgeous stuff. But this makes a knot that is too ginormously thick. It is way too huge. So what I've done is tied a knot around it, and that can even look cleaner than this, because if you're like me and you can't tie bows really well, knots work really nicely. And yes, people are talking about the Bow Easy, and I have not tried the Bow Easy, but I hear it works really great, so I will have to try it sometime. I think somebody sent me one once, and I don't know where it is. It's in my craft room somewhere. But I like to do just knots like this, and I'm going to show you how I did that knot. But this is one of those ribbons that requires a little extra work in order to make sure it ties well. I have this one prepared to show you. Again, this is that thick ribbon. That is super huge of a knot on this thing. If you can see that is ginormous. That would not work on a card. However, what I do is I glue, and I just put a little bit of glue on the back on either side so that I tie that band of ribbon down, and then take a smaller piece, tie a knot in it, and before I secure it all the way down, I can move that to wherever I want on the card, so I can try and see, you know, what position I like it in, and then trim the edges any way I want. If you want to have a fancier edge on your ribbon, instead of just a straight cut, fold it in half and cut it on an angle, and you will end up with two little points. And if you do that on both sides, your little fancy knot can feel as fancy as a bow without being a big old fat fancy bow that's going to get your card all jammed up in the mail. So how cool is that? So I think that's all that's in my fancy little box. And I don't know if you guys have more questions, more ideas, more things you want to talk about. I can cut off the recording and we can just continue chatting for a while because I don't want this to be a huge long thing for everybody to have to watch forever on our blog. But I will have this posted along with the photos of the cards. So I'm going to also add in links to the seminar post. So if you post on your blog and post some cards with some dimensional ideas that you've tried, if you want to ask if it's okay, if what you're trying is too thick or not thick enough, feel free to post them on there and we'll try to come and look at them and see what you have to say about them and let you know if they're too thick or not. And I guess that's about it for today. I will stay online here on Ustream for chatting, but I'm going to go cut off the recording really quick. So keep those cards and letters coming, and I will see you on the blog in a couple minutes with this video, as well as I will be back here to chat. Thanks for coming, everybody.